Hi, this is Karen. I'm from Ohio.
Oh, boy, Karen. Another Karen on the line.
Oh, I'm not one of them kind.
I'm just messing with you, Karen. Go ahead. Who you want to give your donkey to?
I want to give my donkey to Kevin Samuel. Can I tell you why? Woo.
Sure, go ahead.
Yes.
I think that he openly degrades black women, and he preys on their insecurities that have been given to them in previous relationships and their naiveness. And come on, he gave Saweetie a stick. Dr. Umar spoke on him on all that. He deserves donkey of the day.
Yeah, I think he's lame. I do think he's lame. I mean, what age are we where we're rating women and rating people? I mean, he's a grown-ass man. He's 50 years old. But the thing I don't understand is...
You? That's the thing.
But the thing is, which I don't understand is... Why do women keep going to him? Like, that's what I don't understand.
Like I said, he preys on their insecurities that they've been given in previous relationships and their naiveness.
Yeah, because he looks about...
It seems like he hates women. I don't know.
Yeah, it does. I mean, he used to hang around the Hermes store and try to get clientele, you know, just to try to get people. And he used to wear, you know, dress up and stand outside the stores and try to talk to people. I seen him actually a couple of times. It's funny. But in Atlanta. But, I mean, I don't know why women still go to him.
Back up. He said hang out outside the Hermes store.
Yeah, he used to try to hang outside the stores to try to get businesses. So he would hang outside the Hermes store and look for, you know, I guess people with a little bit of money and try to talk to him and try to be a stylist or whatever he was trying to do. I see him out there once or twice. Yeah, it's kind of crazy.
That's weird.
My salesperson from the Hermes store had to remind me, like, you don't remember him? He was the one that was outside the store. I'm like, that was him. Yeah, but he's lame. I don't respect the fact that he sits there and rates women. Oh, this one's a 2 and this one's a 4 and ma, you look ugly. Ma, you're fat. Like, it's just it's a woman must have hurt him.
Hello, my more brothers, back again. And the clip that you just heard was DJ Envy calling Kevin Samuels lame and possibly gay. Can't make this shit up, right? You really can't. And it's hilarious because in the black community, as Kevin says, they use sign language, right? Shame, insults, and need to be right, right? And what do people do, or black people especially do? Do they use corrective behavior, or do they double down on stupid? Basically, all they did was double down on stupid. There's one thing about a viral meme, especially the way the viral meme actually mentioned by Howard Bloom in the Lucifer Principle. Now, a viral meme is so salacious that it spreads on its own, right? And all it needs is a vector. And the Manosphere has tons and tons and tons of what I call viral memes that once they're heard or they're mentioned, whether you like them or not, they will spread. And it doesn't matter whether you love the meme or love the ideas or you hate them. They're interesting enough to be explored and eventually will become part of you and part of the fabric. And similar to the MGTOW community, started arguably in 2010. 5 years later, they were trying to cap it. A year later, it started to go viral and spread out into the mainstream. Now, the Black Manosphere's memes were normally cultural and applied to the Black community. But just like the MGTOW community, the ideas were actually universal, more universal than people actually knew, especially in this feminist society, you know, because the United States is no longer a patriarchy. So the viral memes that the black community has, that the black manosphere has, was eventually going to make its way out. And a lot of academics try to suppress the ideas of the manosphere because they knew, okay, they knew early on how dangerous these memes were. And the first attempt for the viral memes to get out was under Tommy Sotomayor, but that didn't work. He got his taste of mainstream, but it didn't spread. Okay, but the thing is that the difference is that Kevin Samuels actually used all of the red pill, the black manosphere talking points, and he used them effectively. And I think the first inkling that it could go viral, it could go mainstream, was when World Star Hip Hop picked up the clip from Average at Best, and that caught on. Loved it or hated it, it caught on and it started to spread to where non-red pill content creators were actually using the idea. And then they went looking for Kevin Samuels and his content, just like the Google algorithm In the YouTube algorithm, once you start looking for Kevin and his content and Red Pill content, you're going to find other people. And the more Kevin became successful, the more mainstream the idea actually went. It became kind of salacious. And not only did World Star Hip Hop love him, but the Google algorithm actually loved him too. So you had people all over the world through Kevin actually quoting black, not white, but black Red Pill philosophy. And so now we're at almost the tip of the iceberg, right? Well, actually, we are at the tip of the iceberg, where DJ Envy of The Breakfast Club, arguably the most popular show on YouTube, actually spoke his name and kind of hinted at the black manosphere. You have a popular black speaker, which is Umar Johnson, actually talking about the black manosphere. You have all these content creators that knew about especially the black ones that knew about the black manosphere, were trying not to mention it because they didn't want it to gain traction, now openly talking about it. And I remember I said this, God, it's got to be five years ago, maybe almost 6 years ago, about mainstreaming. We were talking about the MGTOW when the UK press wanted to, I think it was the BBC, wanted to interview MGTOW members because they didn't understand it. And once they gave MGTOW its 15 minutes of fame, MGTOW blew up. MGTOW went viral. They even inspired a movie called The Red Pill. They even found a saint in the Red Pill community, Jordan Peterson, who was anti-feminist. So everybody now knows what a MGTOW is. Or if they don't, somebody that they know what a MGTOW is. Love it or hate it. In fact, even the feminists stopped attacking it because it didn't do any good. In fact, it caused it to spread. Because you got a lot of content creators, black and white, that came out of that MGTOW camp. Coach Greg, The Joker, there's a bunch of others got 400,000 subs. Whereas MGTOW content creator, it was hard to crack 5. I remember when I was over there, I barely cracked 1,000. I don't think I cracked 1,000. I think I cracked 500. I cracked 500. And then after I left, my sub count went to 10,000. Even though I wasn't putting any content on there. I have a channel of 10,000 subs that I don't even put content on. That is hilarious. I don't even do MGTOW content in my MGTOW channel that barely cracked 1,000. I don't think it cracked 1,000. All of a sudden jumped up to 10,000. That's how MGTOW went mainstream and when MGTOW went viral. And MGTOW doesn't have half the talking points that the black manosphere has. Not even half. So once we get our 15 minutes of fame, which is, I think we are just about there. Because we got DJ Envy talking about arguably the top black manosphere creator is by sub count, talking about him on open air, on radio, almost like a loyalty test. That means the message is starting to penetrate and the environment that's around us is starting to take effect. So the question is, as I posed to the MGTOWs almost 6 years ago, here comes your 15 minutes of fame. Are you ready for your close-up? And when mainstream comes to you, what are you going to say? Are we going to fight, bicker, and argue, cuss each other out? Or are we going to deliver the message? Are we going to help change the world? Because this is your opportunity. This is your moment. Your moment is coming. What are you going to do? Are you going to actually uphold what you believe in? Or are you going to sell out for the money? This is going to be the acid test about who are you and what you really mean. And what's really behind it? What are you here for? Because I think it was a year ago, everybody was talking about the mission. Everybody's talking about the mission and how it was up to the mission to fight the war, to get things changed. And then when you get the opportunity to effect change on a mass basis, the way that you wanted to effect change on a mass basis, everybody gets cold feet and the real them shows up. Is it about clout and money? Or is it about making a statement on this country about black men's plight and the black man's experience in this United States, but not only its country, its society, but also its women. There's a old saying by a great fighter, Mike Tyson. I use it all the time. And he says, everybody has a plan until they get hit in the face. In other words, when you get rocked, when you're under stress, when you're under pressure, what you really want and who you really are shows up. And that's what you rely on. And this is going to be the acid test. What do you want? And who are you really? And I am dying to know what that answer will be. Because I know where I am and what I stand for and what I want. My question is, do you? What's hidden in the dark will come to the light. And the light of mainstream media is getting ready to shine on you. And when it does, who are you really? With that, I'm going to jump up out of here. This is BGS out. I'll see you guys in the next one. Peace.